Rancher Desktop 1.0, Git 2.35, and a slew of text-based user interface tools. Coming up on The Download. Welcome back to another episode of The Download. I'm your host, Christina Warren, Senior Cloud Advocate at Microsoft. And I decided this week that I wanted to go kind of low-key on my fashion, so I'm rocking a GitHub hoodie. We will have more info on them later. And as a t-shirt, I am wearing is a tribute to my favorite rock star. We miss you, Abel. We've got a ton of news for the week, so let's do this thing. First up, I wanted to pass a huge congrats on over to the team over at Rancher Labs and SUSE on the release of Rancher Desktop 1.0. And Rancher Desktop is an open source app for desktop Kubernetes and container management on Mac, Windows, and Linux. Now, I point this out because the timing of this is fairly important. So back in August, Docker changed the licensing terms for Docker Desktop. And I want to be clear, it's for the desktop program. It's not for Docker itself. It's like the engine. And so this new licensing requires teams with more than 250 or that have revenues of more than 10 million to switch to a new subscription plan. And although those terms are really generous and will likely only impact the largest and most revenue-heavy teams, a lot of people are still looking at potential Docker Desktop alternatives. And because Rancher Desktop can be configured to run the Dockerd container engine under the hood, it might be worth checking out as a replacement. So I've got a link to the SUSE team's website and the download page in the show notes and the description down below. And again, congrats to that team for this release. Next up, Visual Studio 2022 17.1 Preview 3, that's a mouthful, introduces an indexed find in files feature that makes your search experience even faster. And you can see the change in speeds in the GIF. Yes, I say GIF. That is on the screen behind me. But the teams say that 95% of searches in 17.1 Preview 3 find all matches in a search query in just over a second, which is very cool. So, more details about how this feature works and how you can enable it in Visual Studio 2022 17.1 Preview 3 in the show notes and the description. And speaking of Visual Studio 2022, Visual Studio 2022 for Mac Preview 5 is now available. And the big news here is that this is the very first Visual Studio for Mac release running on .NET 6 and natively on Apple's M1 processors. And so as somebody who has a 14-inch M1 Max, this is very exciting to me personally. And going native really speeds things up on the M1. You can check out how much faster loading in a project is taking place in Preview 5 versus Preview 4. And you can get more information and links in the show notes and the description down below. Next up, the Java on VS Code January 2022 update is out now, and the team has also released their roadmap for 2022. So if you are a Java developer and you haven't had a look at the Java extension pack for VS Code, you really should check it out. There's a lot of great work that that team is doing. And actually, if we go to the next slide, you can even see that roadmap. And so I've got links in the show notes and the description down below so you can see all of that stuff. And next up, some great Git news. So first, Git 2.35 is now available. And the coolest new feature for me, I think, is the new staged mode for Git stash. Git stash is a really great way of temporarily storing stuff when you're working on a complicated change. But if you only want to stash away some of your changes, things can be a little more complicated. And so the new staged mode makes it easy to just stash away what you have in the staging area and nothing else. And the GitHub team actually describes it as git commit, but instead of writing a new commit, it just writes a new entry to the stash, which I love. Anyway, I think this is super cool. So for more info on this and the other features in Git 2.35, check out the show notes and the description. And speaking of Git, GitHub is now has a new way of doing two-factor authentication on mobile that I really like. So in addition to using security keys and WebAuthn, you can also set your Android and iOS devices as two-factor authentication methods. And so this basically means that when you log into GitHub, in addition to having a 2FA code or a security key tied to a specific device, like a fingerprint sensor on your laptop, you can also choose to approve that login via the GitHub mobile app on iOS or Android. So you'll get a notification on that device to approve the login. And I like this a lot, especially if you're in a situation where you might be, you know, on a guest machine and might not have your passwords or other stuff. So more details on how this works are in the show notes and the description down below. Next, I wanted to spend some time talking about text user interfaces, or TUIs. I've become obsessed with these lately because I love the idea of styling a CLI tool and like making it look as good as possible. So I wanted to talk about a couple of them. So first I want to talk about Rich, which is a Python library for rich text and beautiful formatting in the terminal. It's really great stuff, love it. It works with Linux, macOS, and Windows, and the true color and emoji stuff actually now works with the new Windows terminal, which is great. And it also works just seamlessly with Jupyter Notebooks, very cool. Next, I also wanna talk about Spectre.Console, which is very similar to Rich, but it's for .NET. So if you're a .NET developer, check that out. And if that wasn't enough, please check out Charm.sh, which is a ton of libraries for building really great CLI apps. And Charm has lots of fun project names like Bubble Tea and Lip Gloss and Glamour and Harmonica. It's really great, big fan. So I've got links to all three of these projects in the show notes and the description. Be sure to let me know your favorite tools for building great CLIs and text-based apps in the comments down below. And now it is time for my pick of the week. So, credit to this one actually goes to the GitHub Twitter account, which pointed out this great blog entry from Lowlighter on dev.2 that shows how you can use GitHub CodeSpaces with VNC and Flexbox to basically create Pokémon maps from a web browser, which is really cool. So Lowlighter built this method out for a project that they're creating, which is available on GitHub, Natch, and it's linked down below. But it just shows some of the power that you can do with GitHub CodeSpaces, where they're literally like launching a web browser in the Docker container, in your code space to then capture stuff. It's really great stuff. Anyway, let me know your favorite Pokemon in the comments down below. Mine is Bulbasaur. And also comment on any other stories that we have covered. Well, that does it for me. If you liked this episode, go ahead and give us a like on YouTube. It really helps us out with the engagement. And go ahead and subscribe to Microsoft Developer for all your nerd needs. See you next time.